everybody. This is exciting for me and to be down here. It's kind of a little far from home, but certainly worth the trip. I saw all your beautiful new school, and this is a great library. I guess you're pretty active. You're doing all these wonderful workshops, so that's very nice. I'm thrilled to be invited. My colleague and friend Betty was my best PR person I have, so she's very kind and very professional, and I love the opportunity to do this. The first thing we're going to do, I'll tell you a little bit of an overview of what we're going to do. I wanted to just do a little exercise with the writing part, okay? So it'll only take a couple of minutes. And then the things that we're going to talk about are the slant of your writing, the size of your writing, the pressure of your writing, and then we're going to do a segment on signatures, which I thought would be kind of fun, just to see how many different ways signatures can be made and what signatures mean in your writing, because I think everyone has a signature. It's the thing you use the most often and throughout your entire life. So we can talk a little bit about why things pop up and change. So that's kind of what I'm going to squeeze into the hour. And the first thing I would like to start with is if you would just, and it says there, copy the sentence using the handwriting style you prefer. People ask, well, should it be cursive or print? If you want to do a sentence of each, that's okay, but do the one you use all the time during the day, most of the time. I know it's a little bit hard to write on some of this. You might want to, you know, write on your, if you want to write on your lap, I know there'll be a little variation, or if you have a purse or your chair, if you want to write on the chair, that's okay. So just write this sentence. This is a sample of my handwriting, and then sign your name under it.
Can I hold it?
If you want to, sure. Sure, absolutely.
Okay.
So I have a lot of experience with teaching penmanship to kids and understanding what they're going through, and I guess today it's been changed quite a bit with less cursive and more printing and less time on penmanship, so sign of the times. You can't fight it. It's technology taking over. That's right. Handwriting's an excellent exercise, though, because what they're finding from the brain is that those pressure patterns you use to bear down with your pen or pencil onto paper is actually stimulating areas in the brain that do not get stimulated when you just have a very light touch to a keyboard. So that's the biggest danger. So at this point, I'm not sure it matters about cursive or print or print script, because some people use both. I think the fact that you're actually writing, even if it's scribbling or drawing or doodling or doing something on that writing surface, because it is, they're really concerned that some of those places might actually atrophy from lack of use. Because again, if you bear down on the keyboard, you're going to get a row of E's, right? You mean, or whatever you press. So you really have to use a very light touch. You know, so that exercise of actually writing is very therapeutic for your brain. So keep that in mind if you want to activate those areas. Okay, now the tricky part here is what I want you to do is switch papers with somebody else, so you don't have your own paper. Yeah, give your paper to someone else. Just trade papers.
Should we do it with one?
Sure, absolutely. Switch papers, that's fine.
I've handed them.
Yeah, I hope nobody in here is enemies, so I think we're all friends, right? No, it doesn't, because you're not going to analyze writing right now. What we're doing is we're just giving you a sample of what handwriting's about. And then you also have your own sample, because for obvious reasons I'm not going to be able to do everybody's. But as I'm talking, you can look at your writing sample to see if any of these things show up in your own writing. But right now what I'd like you to do is underneath that writing sample from that other person is I would like you to copy as closely as you can that writing style. No, just do the print if that's what you're comfortable with, sure. Have you learned cursive at all yet? Are you at an age yet but you're just starting out kind of? Yeah, that's fine. Printing is fine. Yeah, I want you to be the most comfortable you can be when you're doing this exercise. Although I'm not sure that this is a comfortable exercise for people, right? When you're trying to copy somebody else's writing. How many people are having good success with this? How many people are happy about this?
No.
How many people are stress-free?
Oh, stress-free.
I'm not stress-free.
You're not stress-free, I can tell, yeah.
I thought you meant
meant stressed. I thought you were going to say stressed. How many of you are stressed?
And you were going to say yes? You don't have to do the signature, okay? Just do the sentence. Yeah, the signature might be hard. Because generally people will tend to have more, even if they are printers or print script people, they will have a cursive signature. Okay, let's stop that exercise. Let's return the paper back to the original owner.
Your signature's pretty good, girl.
This is showing you.
Yours is actually neater.
What do you think this is demonstrating? Okay, just think about what you just went through. It musters up a lot of nerves and wanting to do a good job and yet having struggling with it. Because this was my big kind of pet peeve in the schools, is that when we have a model and people are taught, and I certainly fell into that category in my early years, to copy the model exactly. Here we are, most of us adults, still struggling with that copying of someone else's writing. So that model is unrealistic to have kids to copy. So my last part of my teaching in elementary school, I started promoting people developing, the kids developing their own style and be comfortable with that. Because we all really, to me, are almost innately, because we're born with who we are, innately born with some of our gifts in the realm of writing. So that's an important element to tap into. So it's a very stressful environment, and imagine if I asked you to do that all day long. You know, it slows you down. Everybody's pace slowed down probably, right? Because you take more time. It's more labor intensive. And then at the end product, how did you feel? Not that great, right? So it really hinders self-esteem because you're saying, well, why are you doing something?
You really know where you can copy someone else's penmanship.
And yet schools are expecting you to.
Oh my God. Really?
So those are things that, yes.
I've trained with my mom, so at least I know she can't force my handwriting.
That's true. And technically, nobody can forge writing because your writing has ownership. Yeah. Everything in your writing belongs to you. So, and I work with forgeries. I go to court, I testify for forgeries, and that's one of the things that I have to prove when I go to court. Does this match or does it not match? And even as much as people try to make it look the same, there's always areas that are not the same. And that's what you capitalize on and you look at in order to assess that. All right, so let's get into now you have your own sample of writing, you have your signatures, so let me go into some of the little specifics about what these things mean, and then you can look at your own writing, and then if you would save your questions to the very end, I think that would be better for time, and then I'm supposed to go till like 2, but I'd be glad to stay a little extra if people had questions, okay? Also, there are books over there that I have written that I brought in. I think you have a book list in your packet. So when we talk about writing and that piece of paper, the minute you, let me put a little magic marker instead of this. The minute you put that dot on a piece of paper, that's you and your environment, okay? And so direction, whether you go this way, or you write a name, or you write, you know, you make a box or a house or whatever, this is your preference, this is your environment. Now some of you, when you wrote really large and covered a lot of the paper. Some people wrote very tiny up in the corner. This starts in kindergarten. When you see kindergartners, they will write, and the teacher might say, well, how come you didn't use the whole paper? Because we don't like to waste paper, right? They want to make sure they use it all. And the kid just likes it down in that little corner. That's their comfort level. And then by forcing them to say, please make it bigger, it's sort of putting them out of their comfort zone. Just like if there's a large writer and you say, oh, please write a little smaller. You know, right away it's like, oh, I have to do something that's not comfortable for me. I have to do something that's out of my element in that regard. So think of that piece of paper as your environment and see how all these things got placed as you wrote them. All right, so the first little cartoon. You know, we get all of this, I think Jeffrey's gonna be a doctor because doctors always got a bad rap for their writing. They just, if you saw legible writing from a doctor, you'd think it wasn't a doctor properly. Today, doctors have taken care of that. They used to send doctors to Penmanship School. UMass Medical School used to do that because they had so many lawsuits for liability against orders that were being written or prescriptions that were being written and misread because their writing was so bad. So an I and an E could change the prescription completely if they couldn't read which one it was. Now they've taken care of it with technology because everything's done through, you know, laptops or iPads, and they're sent directly over to the pharmacy, so they have it in a printed word. So that will, definitely help. So these days are kind of over about worrying about reading a doctor's writing. Some of the things for handwriting analysis, okay, basically it's a study of handwriting for the purpose of determining personality traits. It's an applied science, okay, which means it's just people studying people, and that's where it gets a little subjective because you have to make sure you're a competent handwriting analyst with official training and field practice to know that they know what they're doing. So if you do buy books, it's kind of why I wound up writing some of my books, because I found that some of the books that were out there were very judgmental, very negative, did more harm than help. So that, and then when I read the people's credentials who wrote them, it was like they read a book and then they thought they could write one. So just be leery a little bit of the market out there that, you know, they sell those little books in the supermarket sometimes as you go through the register and oh, this is fun. But often they're inaccurate too, so just, again, be aware of that. But it does have a very high accuracy rate when it is done by someone who has that correct training. This has been taken to court because some people think it's an invasion of privacy. Some companies have hired handwriting analysts for job placement, and they don't, you know, necessarily look at just the personality. They get the job description, and then they see if those traits match the job description. And as I talk about some of the specifics of handwriting analysis, you'll see how that might come into play. But they find that just as you're walking, you're talking, all those things, it's not illegal to do. But you have to willingly, like I don't do third-party analysis, you have to willingly have people hand that handwriting over to you so that it's direct client. I do more direct client than third-party analysis, so, and then that way you know that you have permission of that person to do that, and then nothing is done behind anyone's back. The values of handwriting, in this part I love, it is totally non-discriminatory. And this is some of the myths that people believe over time. It does not identify age, gender, or handedness. And they've done research studies and everything else on all this. A lot of people think, oh, left-handed, right this way, or if it's an old person, it looks like this or that. Honest, there's been no conclusive research that defends any of those. It cannot confirm one's health issues or cultural and religious affiliations. It cannot be used to confirm specific events of one's life or guilt or innocence in any criminal activities. I know Chris started out the talk, she probably see that I, you know, would be a serial murderer. I have written books, actually with writing, it's called Cruelty Continuum, on studies that I did with writing from serial murderers, original writings. And there are a lot of things that show up that would raise some flags about concern, but I only knew they were guilty because they were already in jail. They were already incarcerated. I could not have determined that, and don't let anyone think that they can, you know. So these are important things to understand and why, again, it's really non-discriminatory. The other thing I get questions about, it does not foretell the future. You know, so don't even think, yeah, it's good for the time that you write it. Like this writing, ordinarily if I get writing from people that, I'll have them actually even date it too and say it's only good for the time that you wrote it. Because things can change, your writing can change, you know, and sometimes it increases in size, a little decreases or style changes or whatever. So, you know, this is an important part to understand too. It's interesting to track changes in writing, like if you have writing that you can go back to when you were younger and then see that evolution of your writing style. It's very interesting. So what does handwriting do? Handwriting can assess emotional responsiveness, which we're going to talk about today, which is the slant of your writing. It does talk about stamina and emotional investment, which is the pressure of your writing, which we're going to talk about today. Concentration and awareness, which is the size of the writing that you have. So we're going to talk about those top three things. Then it does talk about learning processes, goal setting and forces to achieve, fears and defenses, and communication styles. Those we're not going to be able to get to today, but I did add a segment on signatures that I think maybe you will find interesting to do. So the main purpose I got into this, and at first it was sort of to help myself because I just was curious about it. I just thought it was interesting. I thought it'd be fun to do. But it is meant to help, not hinder growth. The whole purpose of it is to develop an awareness in yourself to say, okay, you know, we all have limitations. We all have things to feel good about. And then finding that balance is really going to be key to that whole thing. All right, so when I talk about pressure, and I say depth because sometimes you can get width, like if you write with a magic marker, it's going to be look wider than it really is. Like if you look at Donald Trump, when he uses a magic marker and it's a very heavy, heavy signature, he'll usually sign something and then hold it up in front of the TV so you can see it. So it's a heavy, but it's a magic marker. So the depth part of it is pressure. You know, it's like how far do you bear down? So turn your paper over and just feel the back of your pressure paper and just see if you can feel an indentation on the back. Do you feel any kind of indentation on the back?
Yes.
Okay, how many people have pretty strong indentation on the back? Raise your hand if you don't. Okay, there's several of you, good. How many have very light pressure and can barely feel it at all? Okay, there's a few of you. And so the rest might just have that medium range. All right, so if you have it, and this is in your handout on the front of your packet there, that I've actually itemized these three things so you don't have to worry about taking a lot of notes. I did give you extra paper if you wanted to write additional things down. The light person can transition and move on easily, you know, and that's it. When you write light, it just flows across that paper. You know, it's easy to just have it move and go quickly across there. It's hard to bear down a lot and write quickly across your paper. The two kind of conflict a little bit. Medium has time, uptime, and downtime. It's sort of that balance of going either way. They can either let go or they might bear, or they have more consistency in that regard. And then the heavy pressure has endurance and stamina. I mean, they dug into the paper, they dig into life. It's called emotional investment. It's called stamina. It's called endurance. Okay, they can be the workaholics of the world. If you have heavy pressure and small writing, chances are you are a workaholic. How many people have small pressure, heavy pressure and small writing? Anybody in here? One? Are you a workaholic? Oh yeah. yeah, it's just, and companies love to hire them. Why? They get their money's worth, right?
Yeah.
Plus, you know, they really, yeah, they're there, they're invested. They're passionate. It has to be something they love to do, you know. But if they've got a job to do, give me the job and let me go. I'll do it. I'll get it done. So and this is also in school. When kids have that investment there too, they have the stamina to do long-term projects. People with lighter pressure may run out of gas. You know, do you find you run out of gas when you're doing a project and you just either lose interest or you just lose energy and stuff to do? Yeah. You know, and so being a teacher and you understand that, you say, okay, short-term projects or give them a little longer time with the project or whatever needs to be done. It's an easy fix, you know, because we expect everyone to be treated the same, and yet already in this room, we've seen how everybody is kind of different in that regard. So those are important elements to understand with that depth of writing. These are some examples of that. This, I'm not sure, you always have to have an original when you do pressure. There are a couple of seats down front here if you'd like to sit down and stay. Feel free to come in, that's fine. That's okay. No, we're just starting into the nitty gritty part, so I think you'll be okay. Having the original, like I couldn't have, if I had a copy of somebody's writing, I couldn't ask them to turn that over and feel the back because it'd be all the same. You really need an original. And then the other thing is too, those of you that wrote a little bit heavy, in spite of whatever the surface was, sometimes you have to write on two or three different pieces of paper in order to get a little bit of a pressure pattern too. But because one piece of paper, like on a laminated surface, it might not show up as much. You know, but I can remember having a composition book I gave a kid in the third grade, and I had them write as hard as they possibly could to see. Of course, carbon paper, I guess, is non-existent anymore and has fallen by the way of the dinosaurs. But he pressed through, and he kept flipping pages,
And he said, look, Miss Page, I went through 6 pages. He indented into 6 pages of writing. So that's how hard you can put. And he was invested, sometimes in the wrong things, but he was invested in what he did. You never know the events of what they're invested in. But when he had his mind to put up, sometimes it can be a little stubbornness too about saying, you're not gonna move me, I'm dug in. You know, so every trade has a plus and a minus. And so here you have the three different extremes. Most people write in this range. There's actually like a scale of like 1 to 6 or something that you can rate some of these. But anyone that's really dug in, they really have, and those kids also, and maybe even people on a job have trouble. If they're invested in something we want to do and someone says, okay, stop that and do this, but I'm not finished here. You know, they want closure or they want to have that done. Do you find you have that happens to you? It says that? Yeah, so they want to make sure, yeah. So that can be the disadvantage where a light writer would say, oh, sure, give me the next thing, no problem, I'll go back to it or whatever. So everybody has kind of a place in that regard. When I talked about not being able to see age in writing, this is really important. Now, this woman's 90 years old from Ireland. And I love her stationery. Tease me about my age and I'll beat you with my cane. I mean, she has a lot of energy. She has a lot of stamina. She has a lot of, you know, so this is why when they say, oh, well, you know, writing will turn this way when you do this, or you know, maybe, maybe not. There's nothing that confirms those findings, you know. So, you know, you have people are living now. Every night I'm reading about people in 100, 103, and they're walking around and talking and living at home. So, I mean, it's a different generation now. So that stamina can last whatever, and sometimes that stubbornness of not giving up works out well for these people, you know, because they're gonna make sure they hold their independence and stay what they can do. All right, so now we've did the pressure, so let's see the size of the writing. And when you do size, you look at just those mid-zone letters, which are all like your A's and E's and M's and N's and all that. It's not so much, they don't measure the extenders that come off of that thing that goes into the upper area or the lower below the baseline. It's all the mundane letters that you're looking at. And those can fall into a very small, and again, there's grids and everything that you measure these with, but I'm not going to go into the details about that. But the small is the focuser. They see the details. They tend to be maybe a little bit more introverted or you know, want to narrow down the scope. They look at the trees as opposed to the forest, as opposed to the large writer who's apt to see the forest and miss the trees. And again, we need everybody, because I can't imagine a people that just focus on this or not see the big picture. And this is what I was talking about with concentration and awareness. You know, the concentration is the small writer who's going to look at certain things and spend time on that one thing. You know, when they travel, guess what? They want to go to one country and see everything that one country has to offer. When they go to a museum, they want to read all the little signs on the museum. Know that ahead of time if you're a small writer. We went to the Museum of Science when Da Vinci had, as an inventor, and we went with a really tiny writer, and most of us, you know, could read and look and read and look and move on. Well, he was reading every, took him like 3 hours to get through the exhibit. So, and then I wasn't doing handwriting, but if I knew that now, I'd say, okay, you go through it, we'll meet you at the end, we'll be in the coffee shop, we'll be somewhere else shopping, and then we'll come back and get you. So it's not like, you know, that awareness part of knowing ahead of time can give you a big edge, you know, to say, that's fine, there's nothing wrong with that, but that's their preference, where he couldn't believe we raced through it the way we did. So everybody wants to spend different times doing different things. The medium writer, again, shifts, okay, between the focusing and scanning, so they can adjust and adapt to both areas. They're not as set in that one particular way of thinking about things. And then the larger writer is the scanner, the big writer who that paper would be filled if you asked them to write a few sentences. You know, they want to experience everything life has to offer. If you travel with them, what do they want to do? They want to go, yeah, have you traveled with someone like that? You just, yeah, just like, where are we going today? Where are we going today? Because they get, large writers get energized by being around people over long periods of time. Small writers are exhausted by the same situation.
How about medium writers?
Medium writers, again, they can do what they have to do to blend, I guess, you know, and to meet the standard, yes. You know, so, and this is an important thing to know too, you know. Again, if you're working with someone and you've got to share a space with them and share a job with them, when I was teaching in cooperative learning, you know, knowing who's going to focus on this and the big picture or the small picture, sometimes that grouping can really help. Because you don't want to put, if you put a whole bunch of tiny writers together, they may not communicate their ideas. They may sit with them, they may think about them, and they may do them. But as far as the cooperative part is where they're going to fall short. But with a large writer, guess what? They'll be in the cooperative part. They'll have a big social gathering, but as far as getting the work done, that's where they can fall short. So again, everyone has that strength and weakness that they can offer to the program. Here's a good example of a small writer. Now this is a postcard, so you know, I mean, with a microscope, you can read this a little bit. But this writer, it's quite legible. He talks about being a scientist, being at MIT, going to try. So he is in the right field because he's probably a researcher. They're perfect researchers, you know, because they love to be alone. They love their cubicles. They love their equipment. They love, you know, things that aren't interrupting. Small writers do not like to be interrupted. If you live or work with a small writer, chances are you have to make an appointment with them. You know, because they get invested in what they want to do, and they're not trying to be antisocial or rude. They're just trying to do what they like to do. You know, I used to have a friend that say that she was a small writer and she loved to go out to eat by herself. And her friends always felt sorry for her. Guess why? Because they thought she was doing this because she had no friends. No, she did this because she took her book, she went, she was served, she had a relaxing night, all good. So we put our values sometimes on other people and not meaning to do so. So this handwriting field opened my eyes to accepting all these diversity things, not as a problem anymore, as just the way people function. And so it really helps you learn to again, be more tolerant of that, those differences. And they start early on. You will see tiny writers in first and second grade. This isn't something they become later on. You know, they'll be little kids. When you have a first grader and you're doing cooperative learning and they come up to you and say, can I work alone? Guess what? Chances are they're a small writer. Small writers rather work alone. Why? Because what?
They want to get it done.
They're probably time efficient. You know, they don't feel the need to socialize with everybody and do all that stuff. You know, and they're just, and again, if it's something they like, they'll be invested. Very focused, yeah. Yeah. So, you know, so like I said, and a good motto for the small writer, use it up, wear it out, make it do or do without. They're very frugal. So when they travel, they'll find, they probably, if you got a travel agent that was a small writer, you'd probably save a lot of money because they'd find the cheapest and the best way to go. They may not go to all the places you want to go, so it could be a little limiting, but it would be, you know, they would look for the sales and things like that. When it came to something they like, they may go for the gusto, but most of all, they live a very conservative lifestyle from that perspective. This one is like, if you don't learn to sign your name smaller, it'll never fit on the lines, or on the checks, it says. So large writers, and this can be problematic because a lot of the forms, sometimes you have to sign a little itty-bitty line if you have a long name. I have a nice short name, so I'm okay, but if you have a long name that you've got to squeeze into these itty-bitty lines, it's really tough to do. Did you find it's tough to do if you have to write on that? Yeah. You know, so this is what happens. Now, this is a large writer, and this is an adult, probably in her 40s, woman. And her life is just experiencing everything. I mean, she was a dance instructor. She was a mom. She was, you know, living a life. She was planning travel. She was doing, I mean, there wasn't an ounce of space. In fact, when she came to bring the writing, because it was sort of an event that I did, and she says, I only have 2 minutes. Can you do this in 2 minutes? I was thinking, but she was booked somewhere else to go somewhere else at the event. So this is what they overbook, and this is the danger, because sometimes they spread themselves so thin, their stress comes from too much. And so they have to be careful they don't put that plate too full and carry on. Plus, imagine if you traveled with this person. You know, that would be exhausting. If and even if you were two large writers, why would it be exhausting?
Why? Yes.
Because she rushed and if they want to have you to have time, just say no, because it may take me a little longer.
Okay.
Than I can take.
Okay,
now,
that's perfect.
In my classroom, I'm in fourth grade, but in my classroom, we usually don't have time for tests, but for other things we have time, like math. I can't finish because sometimes I'm confused.
Okay, sure. And time things with a large writer, I'm glad you brought that up, because that's really important. Time is of the essence. You know, and if you're a large writer and you get easily distracted, because that's what happens with large writers too, that they're always scanning the room. You know, so they'll see what's going on here, there, and everywhere, where the focuser can block out more distractions and stay focused, so that's why they're more time efficient. So that's what can happen with this. They get a little bit, too much. When is too much? Too much. But timed issues are always a factor. So here we have two people that are completely, look at this tiny writer, and then look at this larger writer. So if they were working together, this is sort of like, let me do this and I'll get back to you kind of thing. And then this one would be saying, but what are you doing? I want to know what you're doing. And they'd be in their face all the time. So you can see where, again, it's not a value judgment on who's right and who's wrong. It's just where their comfort level is. That's really what we're dealing with here, is establishing a comfort level and then learning how to manage it somehow so you can work in the environment wherever you are existing from that perspective. All right, so the next thing we're going to do are slants. Now, this is your emotional responsiveness. And when I say responsiveness, it's like how much emoting do you do, or do you feel like you need to do? So we've done the heavy pressure, the light pressure, we've done the size for the different. Now we're getting to whether you slant forward or upright or back or mixed or whatever that is. The forward writer, okay, is always drawn to others. It's this writing that's leaning forward. How many forward writers do we have in here?
What do you mean by forward?
It slants forward. It slants forward. Okay, so that's going to be, okay, then we have slightly forward where it's not really far forward. Like this would be an example of far forward, the one I just showed you here. Let me just put that one back on. This would be far forward. You see how that's really racing against the paper there? This might be a little bit forward, so it's not as extreme. Then we have vertical, and this is more decisions of the head. Then we have backward, and then we have variable. So let's take each one, and you can see. This would be an example of the forward writer. You see how the person's kind of leaning forward? They're leaning towards others. Their heart is involved in that. They're emotionally involved with that situation. So their decisions tend to be more in that realm. Then we have the vertical writer, and these are near vertical, and these are people that are more objective. They can step back from a situation and see things more objectively. So that's kind of their contribution that they make, because sometimes we need objective writers to set things straight. This is why that writer that's kind of slightly forward is going to have a little tug of war between their head and heart, saying, well, they make good mediators, they can see both sides, but the tough part is making the final decision. That's really where they're struggling. And then the backhanded writer, people had this myth about more left-handed is right back, but they really don't. Left-handed writer is more like a little bit standoffish, a little bit, they want to join and connect and stuff, but their trust is a little thing for them, because they just feel like, wait a minute, should I trust you? Should I move forward? Should I, where should I go? What should I do? So they're more cautious, I would call them. Then we have the variable writer, where their slant is going in all different directions, and it may be because their life is going in all different directions. They've got things that they're emotionally involved in and other stuff they have to stand back. They might have a job where they have to be objective, but their personal life is all emotional. So you'll find that kind of what I call a little bit of emotional turmoil in there, because they're, unsettled, and that can represent some stress. But you don't know why, you don't know the events, you don't know, it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter age, gender, anything. It's just, and if I see that writing, sometimes I'll say, is there something going on in your life that's making you feel like you're being pulled in all different directions? Because that's what's happening.
you know, I had one a high school student making a decision about the college, and it's like one of the parents wanted to go here, she wanted to go there, she was being pulled in all these different directions, and her writing was going in all different directions. So those heavy duty decisions can sometimes make a big difference that way. So you can see here, like these two people traveling, where this one's like, oh yeah, but look at this, let's go. They tend to be a little more impulsive, they tend to be a little bit more reactive. Where this person's, well, let's stop, let's think it out. Like, this is an insurance adjuster, so perfect job. You know, let's get the facts, let's act, you know, think before we act. These people act and then think later. So they can be oops people, and that's what you have to be careful out, because sometimes, yeah, that just, their heart gets the way of them, and then they overreact sometimes. So that's sort of in a nutshell all those three things. I know I fired a lot of information at you, but you know, this is an important element for your own reactions, okay, to maybe put the brakes on if you need to. And then also when you're working or living with other people, dynamics in a family can have these same differences. You know, you can have all these different slants, and you know, even within your family. Dynamic to see, you probably know in your head, sometimes I have see people react and I envision what their writing would look like, you know, that they are probably impulsive and reactive and want to do that, and other people are just standing there and you're thinking, wow, they look kind of cold and detached, when actually I call them quiet observers, you know, they just watch and look and listen. So, and we need everybody, you know, because we don't want everybody overreacting, but we don't want everybody just standing there watching either. So there's something in between where you try to find the balance between the two things. All right, so now we're going into signatures, okay? And this is kind of fun, and everybody has a signature on the page that they can look at their own signature. And then, like I said, when you go home, maybe you can dig up other signatures that you have and see how they fit in. The original signature in the Stone Age, people blew through a pen and wrote their hand on a wall, and that was their signature. And everybody's hand was different, so that, you know, they could tell what that was. Another way the signatures came about was people that came over from other countries and didn't speak the language, they would put an X on their paper, and that was accepted, because everybody's X would be made a little bit differently. And that's all they could do at the time to say, you know, sort of X marks the spot, this is what I was here. So we've certainly moved a long way from that part. Early on, penmanship styles were in the, I want to say, 17th and 18th centuries, were very set. Like a certain tradesman would have a certain style they would stay with. A laborer would have a style. Anyone else, a laborer, you know, would have something different from a lawyer, let's say. So with Bach, you can see the influence of their penmanship throughout their style. And some of the early research on handwriting analysis was done with the concept that you need to know what the penmanship style was to tell a little bit more about the person. But today, that can't apply because there's too many handwriting style, you know, models out there. There's too many ways that people teach penmanship. There's so many variations in that there's no way to narrow that down. It might have been easier in the 18th, 19th century, but really, you know, after that, so you don't really need to know it. It might give you a little bit more information, but you can still do the analysis without knowing what model, because most everyone varies from the model anyways. You know, I haven't seen anyone that has actually replicated the model as their normal handwriting. You know, some may look close to it, you know, because they like that traditional look, but it's rare that you see that. So what are signatures? Throughout your lifetime, no other combination of letters is more refined, polished, rehearsed, revised, tinkered with, toyed with, and than your signature. So you go through ages. I mean, certainly adolescents, they go through playing with their signature. Oh, I like my dad's, I like my mom's, I like my friend's, I like this, you know, and so you play around, you try different things. You know, if you get divorced or remarried, I've had people say to me when they have to change back to their maiden name and make that adjustment to redo their last name, they have an adjustment to make. So anything that's going on with your identity, you know, is going to affect your signature, because that is basically who you are. Some people are so famous that this one says you don't have to sign your last name, mommy and daddy will know golly who. So. You know, how important is the last name? Your first name sets you apart from your connected clan, okay? Your connected clan is your family name. But then adding your first name makes that the unique part of that whole plan. So it is an important element, but of course, in Celebrityville, you know, we know that there's certain people that one name and you know immediately who they are. So when we look at the first and last name, what does this tell you about this person? Look what's happened. Mm-hmm. You know, his name, I save all my junk mail. I don't know if anyone else does. You can get great signatures off your junk mail. So this was junk mail. And see, once it's sent out by a bad mass mailer, it's yours because they've given it to you willingly, right? So it's not a problem. And I don't even remember who he was the national, what company he was national president of, but James E. is there. So that's his name. That's all about him. What happens to his family name? And then he goes right to junior, flatline. So he's either, and I've had this happen, and it's a sad event, sometimes his whole family dies off and the connection's gone. Sometimes they've had an out with the family and they don't want to be associated with it. You don't know why it's there, you just know that the clan he's connected to seems to be missing. You know, because there's no, and again, there's that good indication that no matter how you were taught how to write, you know, this is still his rendition of what he wanted to do for his own writing style. And this becomes very unique to that person. Now, when you look at it, look at your own signature if you have an emphasis on your first or your last name. So if you'll notice everything on the left, all right, their emphasis is all on their first name. In fact, the one in the middle, even their family name has a lowercase, and she has a big capital on her name. So it's sort of like, who's in the limelight there, you know, whatever they're going through. On the other side is just the opposite. The initials on the family name is much larger, and their identity is a little bit dwarfed. So this tells you how important that connection is. That's really what it shows you. You know, and it could be, again, that they're older and their families, now today everybody's so mobile, people move away, you know, so sometimes contacts get lost, sometimes things happen that change that, so you don't know why, it's just there, you know, that is there. So look at your own writing, do you see, sometimes it's equal, which means, or maybe even just slightly different a little bit, but you can see whether that has changed a lot. Does anybody have big differences in their capital letters for their first and last name? Do you? Yeah?
Instead of me doing...
you're going to have to write... just talk a little bit louder, please.
Instead of me doing a capitalized T for my first name...
Yeah?
And the lowercase for my last, I do a capital on both.
Okay. Yeah, and that's what school teaches you, which is good. You know, at your age, that's nice to give equal... you know, importance to each one, so that's good. Did anybody have a difference of their signatures? Yes?
My last name is slightly bigger than my first name.
Okay, so your connection to your family seems to be very important to you that way, you know? Obviously, you brought your mom. That's a good sign. yeah, and again, it's not, don't think of any of this stuff as a value judgment. It's just sort of a stage that you're going through, an importance to your life, or, you know, whatever connection that you have in that regard. So those are things that, again, people, you'd have to fill in or ask if that was possible. As far as legibility goes, we all know John Hancock was known for the biggest and the largest of signatures for his writing on the Declaration of Independence there, and definitely has this flourish. You know, so the fact it was bigger and then he embellishes it even more tells you that he wanted everyone to notice that he had made a commitment and he was proud of it and he didn't care who knew it. So it was definitely out there. Now, we get some of these, it doesn't quite have that same feeling, you know, because they almost, these are older signatures. This one's not quite as older, but they get too decorative. It almost goes into ostentation where it's not pleasing to the eye. It's too much. And just imagine how long that took to do that. You know, that's just, yeah, it's just a lot of, almost like stressors to me when they keep going and perseverate over the lines like that. Now, these were signatures that were done in the year 2000, so these aren't that older. But these are all signatures that, again, were just hard to read, hard to decide, you know, just very difficult, you know, so, and I don't know if this is because people are in a hurry. Sometimes your signature deteriorates a little when you're in a hurry. Sometimes it's because you didn't really learn cursive and you're just making stuff up as you go along. So there's lots of reasons why this can happen. Now, here's the abbreviated form of all these things. These were, you know, George Clooney, what he's done is he's just done two initials. But when you see that, sometimes it's not important that you read a name, sometimes it's more important that you recognize one. So once I saw that, every time I see that, I know that's George Clooney's, because it leaves an impression in your mind. It's like a symbol. Signatures become symbols of what you write. This is Brad Pitt, and he's just taken B and P and then connected it. It looks to me very religious in a way. And I guess he was a Presbyterian minister in one of his movies or something, so I don't know if that influence came through there. And then this is Ben Affleck, which again is just taken a few strokes and shortened it. When you write your name a lot, sometimes they shorten it anyways, and they might just use initials, or they might develop a logo or something, because, you know, and again, these have kind of line value, so I can see where, it's pleasing to the eye to look at, because it kind of flows and moves and has a certain amount of rhythm to it. Sometimes, you know, when you have, it gets too busy, this is Angelina Jolie's, you know, hers is much more angular, very small writer. So she's in that small writing category, even though she has these strong, very strong, these are very strong disciplining strokes where when she, you know, wants to make her mind up, she will make her mind up. And yet she's, again, this small writing too, I think she tends to be a more private person. You don't see her out in the limelight all the time. You know, I think she does, like, she's in the limelight when she's in the celebrity mode, because your signature kind of represents how you are in the public. And then the text of your writing represents how you are in your private life. So there are two things, and you see her writing matches a little bit in style, but look at how much bigger her signature is than the rest of her writing. So this can tell you that her life out in the public is probably more, you know, front and center. And her base of her writing is more in the background, and she really likes her private life that way. Here's another one too. I don't know who remembers Jane Mansfield, but you know, this is the text and the signature that tends to be more similar. It's larger, but the style is kind of similar. But you can see all these hearts and all these other things that are all flourishing. You know, all this attention, all these loops are all desire for attention and imagination. And she, I guess, was infatuated with pink. I mean, in addition to all the hearts, she had, I guess, a pink house and a pink pool and a pink this, and, you know, just really got caught up in all of that stuff. This is Paris Hilton's. And again, we see this printing. She's of that generation where there are more printers, but has developed a more flourishing, you know, penmanship for that type of thing. This was a letter written when she went to jail for possession of drugs or something, and had to spend, I don't know, so many months in jail. So she wound up doing that, and that's why she said she's being very strong and trying to do that. But you can see how this is very, I call it large writing, you know, so for her to be contained in a cell and not be in the limelight was very stressful for her. You know, you can see almost like the letters are kind of touching each other and compressed and everything, so you can kind of see the tension where, you know, definitely her stress was evident, and she talks about her stress in the letter for sure. You know, and all the little X's and O's and things like that. I forget who she was writing to in this. Michael Jackson is another one. Now we have a lot of different writings. His writing, his signature changed a lot. You know, and rightfully so, because he's had a lot of different lifestyles as far as the singing careers and then all the bad publicity he got and everything. But his base of his writing is much more less regular, less formed, than the signatures are very highly stylized, you know, a lot of loops and a lot of star quality here and all this other stuff that he liked to be in the limelight to a degree. And yet this other part of him wanted to be private too. So he has that. So what this tells you, where it's kind of bigger and then smaller here, is that there's not a match. With celebrities, you're more apt to get that because they're in the limelight so much. I think they probably do cherish their private life more than anyone does. Here we have, I love these that have sort of like symbolic gestures to them. I mean, this is Mae West. Now, you'd never know that was an M and a W, but this represented her her celebrity lifestyle was about her femininity. And then up here we have Fred Astaire and Ginger Rogers. To me, these look like two signatures dancing across the floor. You know, so they can represent kind of what you do also, which is interesting, where some people take the time to actually incorporate that in. Here's Liberace's, and he put a piano in his signature. Now, I don't imagine he did that all the time, but that was his first name. Here we are. He didn't need a last name, right? There's anybody else Liberace that you know of that would be that famous. So he got to be able to, you know, appreciate that from that perspective. Okay. So, any questions on signatures, or any questions on anything that I've sort of fired at you? I know I kind of fired a lot of information at you, a lot to process, but anyone have any questions? I do have a whole book on signatures over there from different lifestyles and different trades. They lead like a dual life, you know. They have this one private life that they do work hard, most of them anyways, to keep private, and then they have this on-screen life that is completely different. So, and now again, some of them are just getting to be very scribbly and very, they've abbreviated a lot of them. I saw someone, and signatures are really quite expensive. I mean, Brett Favre, when he was signing footballs for his career with the Green Bay Packers, he got $65,000 for 2 hours of signatures. And they sold it later in retail. I said they think they made like $100,000 on it. So it's big business. So, but I recommend if you're collecting signatures or celebrity signatures or anything, you know, be very cautious because there's a lot of fraud in that field. And unless you have a picture taken with that person being signed or something, or it has a, because I'm finding even now the certificates that come along with these things have been forged. So there's no guarantee. So if you're collecting them and you spend $5 or $10, fine. But I would never recommend spending hundreds and thousands of dollars on some of these things because they're the community of fraudulent activity is running rampant in that field for sure. Anything that's got a signature on it from there. Yes?
When I studied handwriting before, many years ago, it showed if someone had a health issue, like if they had a headache or if they had or something wrong with their leg. But I came a little bit late, so I don't know if you covered that.
I did. It's one of the areas that is certainly a lot of research is being done with it. I'm not an advocate of that because, number one, I'm not a doctor. I don't have a medical background, and I haven't seen any conclusive research that makes that determination secure enough for me to use it. So, you know, you can take it under advisement. I know there's books out there on it. There's that, but I just think it's a very dangerous area because I think if you were working with a doctor and the doctor could confirm your findings, it would be one thing. But I would never. There are some people that say, "Oh, you could have a heart attack. You could do." I said, "Why would you do that? I mean, you know, I don't want to play God. I don't want to give somebody a medical diagnosis that I'm not trained to do." So I strongly, personally, would never do that, but I understand there's people out there that do.
But it's not like to make a diagnosis, it's just, and it's true a lot of times.
It can be, you can be, it's possible to be true. I just personally don't feel comfortable doing it, but again, I just don't feel like I have the training to be able to use it accurately or even do that, you know, because it may be false too, and then you may put a person in, you know, to a frame of mind that makes them sick because of what they heard.
Well, I think just what she's saying, like if they had a headache or something, that would be easy enough to say, did you have a headache when you were writing this? I mean, I don't think she's like diagnosing people with cancer or anything like that, but like I get what she's saying, like, oh gosh, maybe there was a little more pressure that day when you were pressing down with pressure. You know,
I would say stress maybe, but I would never specifically say it was, you could have arthritis in your hand and that could be part of it too, but I would ask, I would ask if you are on medication, if you have any health problems, I would get that information up front if it was critical, but to tell whether someone has a headache or not. Number one, the purpose of handwriting analysis is to help people become aware and understand and more understanding. And I don't know, telling somebody they have a headache, I don't know that would make a difference one way or the other,
no,
or
it would
be helpful?
More of, you know, like, say that you had something wrong with your knee, like you have your knee reflex.
Oh. Sure.
And it might show up in your handwriting, because when you had your downstrokes, you would have like a little knot at that area.
I've seen people
so,
do that.
So, I mean, it wasn't like diagnosing or saying you're going to have a heart attack. Or, you know, it's
but
something that comes, that even afterwards you ask me, yeah, but I have to have a knee replaced. Or, you know, I have a problem with my elbow. Or,
okay.
I mean, it's more simplified.
Yeah, I mean, it's still technically a diagnosis, but I mean, it's, you, I mean, again, I personally would have to feel comfortable with some type of medical training before I started getting into any medical mentioning at all of anything. I don't feel I can do a complete analysis of someone's personality without, and most of, when I see areas that are distressed or that have areas that shouldn't be there, I just come right out and say, you know, have you had surgery I need to know about? Are you on meds you have to know? So I just ask them right up front, because there's no guarantee. There's no guarantee. So you could mention that to 10 people and maybe half of them say yes and half of them say no. And until I get more definitive, conclusive research, I don't think it's an area that I personally choose to go into, just because of my comfort level, and I don't find that information useful. If I say to someone, I see this, you might have a knee thing, and they say, oh yes, what does that do? What is that? What information does that give me that's going to help them? I want to have people feel good about themselves. I want to have people understand who they are, separate from all their ills, separate from all their other things, you know? And so I guess a lot of people that are trained take different approaches. I just don't take that approach, you know? So it's a personal choice. And I know there's books out there about it.
That would be more about like people that are just doing it as
you know, the thing is, there's no licensing in our field, so it's an open area where people just choose to do whatever they choose to do. And there's a danger in that, because a little bit of knowledge can be a dangerous thing. And so sometimes it can, if you get somebody, you know, that takes these things to heart and is really damaged by it, it can do more harm than good, as far as I'm concerned, yeah. So, you know, and it's funny, because I do these corporate events, and I have to do these rapid-fire analyses where I'll tell people a few things within a few minutes, and then they move on, and the next one's coming. And one guy actually said to me, you know, you didn't tell me anything bad about myself. Now, I tend to be a positive person. I always look at the good, and I always see good and bad in everything, and it's, again, not a value judgment, it's just there. And I said to him, I said, you know, I find people beat themselves up enough all on their own. I don't need to join you in that. I would like to give you things that you can feel good about yourself and leave here, you know, knowing that you have valuable things to be proud of, too. So human nature tends to beat yourself up. So I start talking about people's aches and pains, they're not going to go away with a good feeling. You know, their doctor can talk about that. You know, if they've got an issue with their knee, let them go to their doctor and find out about it. You know, I don't want to be responsible for that. And I don't want them to go to the doctor and say, my handwriting analyst told me I have an issue with my knee, you know, and they'd say, what is this? Yeah. And this is one of the things, when I go to court, they separate completely. They won't let me testify on anything that I'm not trained in. So I'm only trained in handwriting as a personality or as a question document work for comparisons. And if I ever mention anything medical, they would disqualify me. So if you need expertise in those areas in order to render an opinion of any kind in there. So, and again, it's just been my personal choice that I don't feel that that's knowledge that would make a difference in my assessment. Focus, but also as professional as I can be also, in that I'm not treading on areas that I don't feel qualified to tread on. So, you know, that's just what's worked for me, you know. I guess from that perspective, because I got training in the court work, and then I got training in the personality too, of the profiling part. So, and then the penmanship, I also even tutor penmanship, you know, from time to time. And I have adults ask me to tutor them in penmanship, which I find is interesting.
Yeah, well, nowadays they print or they go on the computer. No one even writes.
Well, it's getting limited, that's for sure, I know. And I don't know where that's going. Maybe it'll have a rally and a comeback, I'm not sure, but. All right, any other questions, anything else? Thank you very much for coming, I appreciate it, and have a good day.